Are you sure the metal you're working with is of the right grade that you need? Don't leave it to chance. In this video, you'll find out the easiest way to test it out. The optical emission spectroscopy is an almost non-destructive testing that leaves behind a superficial mark on the sample that can be removed later on. This video is divided into two sections. The first deals with the principle of operation of the OES. To be more specific, this is the Spark-OES method. The second section deals with the intricacies regarding the testing and precautions that you need to take to get accurate results. Jump to that section that you find interesting. Let's go. The sample is placed on a stand with the electrode at a predefined distance below it. The electrode typically is made of tungsten, although graphite electrodes have been used in the past for non-ferrous materials. This enclosure is filled with argon to detect light elements that are below 200 nanometer wavelength, such as carbon, sulfur, phosphorus, and nitrogen. An electrical pulse with a high voltage in the range of 1000 volts is applied between the electrode and the sample surface, resulting in the ionization of the atmosphere. This allows it to conduct electricity. A plasma is formed, heating the material to several thousand degrees. The excited atoms in the metal reach a higher state that is not very stable. To reach stability, the electrons fill the hole left behind, leading to an emission of a photon. Each photon is characteristic of a particular element. For example, molybdenum emits photons having a wavelength of 202 nanometer, 281 nanometer, 308 nanometer, and 369 nanometer. We are interested in capturing the photons in the visible and part of the UV spectrum, which is why this is termed as optical emission spectroscopy. The radiation emitted by the element is directly fed to the spectrometer optics or via an optical fiber. This light is split up at different angles by the diffraction grating and sends it to a particular detector for that element. The detector is usually made up of photomultiplier tubes, CCDs or CMOS, each having its own advantage and disadvantage when it comes to robustness and cost. The detector is pre-calibrated such that when it measures the intensity of the incoming rays, the concentration of the element can be determined. Here we are in section 2. We will go over 6 important factors to be kept in mind while testing the specimen. Before we get into it, I'm going to demonstrate the testing for you. I'm going to place the sample on the stand and let the spectrometer do all the work. A sound is generated, which indicates the high voltage spark. Now let's move on to the important considerations. Point number 1. The metal specimen should be nearly flat and the surface should be smooth. This is achieved by grinding the specimen with a disc. Here, we are using a 60 grit disc. Point number 2. The surface should cover the entire specimen stand. No air gap should be present. The oxygen and air can interfere with the results of light elements. Point number 3. The purity of argon can influence your results. The purity is therefore kept to over 99.998% at minimum. Over time, the electronics and the detectors inside the spectrometer start to drift. Periodically use drift correction samples to maintain accuracy. Point number 5. Use a certified reference material, also called as a CRM, to check for the accuracy of the spectrometer. Use a similar grade CRM alone for verification. For example, do not use a low alloy CRM to check if your results of a stainless steel is okay or not. And finally, point number 6. You need to take a minimum of 2 sparks and report the average. During the testing, we made an error, only for demonstration purposes, where 2 of our sparks overlapped. This does not guarantee good results, so always ensure that each spark is distinct and is at a distance from each other. Let us have a quick look at the results. 2 sparks were taken and the results are shown in the table. Depending on the program, over 20 elements are generally displayed. The trace elements have been filtered out for our case. The material is identified as stainless steel due to its high chromium and nickel values. I have then matched the element with our extensive database to narrow down the grade as UNS S31008 or 310S as per ASTM A240. And that's it for this video. If you enjoyed this and would like to see more such related testing videos, subscribe to the channel and leave a comment below on what you'd like to see next. Thank you.